I'm Deirdre, DeLa Cruz. I am an associate professor of Philippine history and Philippine studies here at the University of Michigan. I'm going to talk to students in the audience about imposter syndrome. This is a really common experience. It is kind of something that comes out of feeling alone. There are ways that we can employ so that we don't feel so alone, so that we don't end up having that sense of deep insecurity. I want them to, first of all, and maybe most importantly, know that they're not alone. The feeling of being an imposter, of being a fraud, of not being good enough, like all of those kinds of experiences and feelings, that they're really commonly shared. So I want them to feel like they're not alone in this, that this is a very common set of experiences, and I want them to have kind of a set of tools to help combat it.
Hi, everyone. As Romeo said, I am Professor Deirdre Dela Cruz. I think that officially makes me the elder of the program. I am so grateful to be here. I'm especially grateful to my students who invited me here. I've been thinking about the theme for today, be unapologetically you, and I've been asking myself what that means. And I suppose one way to begin thinking about it is by thinking about our own background. So I'm gonna start by saying a little bit about myself. I'm a crazy mix of things, even by Filipino standards. My dad migrated from the Philippines when he was in high school. He himself is a mix of Ilocano, Tagalog, and Indian. My mother grew up on the Big Island of Hawaii. Her parents also grew up and were born on the Big Island of Hawaii, and they were Chinese, Portuguese, and Korean. I was born in Germany. But the places I called home have been Hawaii and Seattle. I grew up in Seattle mostly. I went to school at the University of Washington, which is where I got my bachelor's degree. And I guess because I didn't have enough study, I went on to get a PhD in cultural anthropology at Columbia University in 2006. Columbia University. PhD, right? If I had a dollar for every look of surprise on someone's face when I said I had a fancy PhD, when they see that I'm a tenured professor, I could probably go into early retirement. I exaggerate a little bit. But it is true, people have tended to greet me with surprise. There's a guy I remember meeting at a party once, and upon learning that I had a PhD, he said, "Oh, where'd you get your PhD?" I said, "Columbia." He said, "Oh, is that where you're from?" "Am I from 116th Street? Is that what?" Oh, you mean Colombia. Yeah, no. No offense against Colombians. I'm sure they're great. I'm sure they got great universities. But actually, my PhD is from Columbia University in the city of New York. Ivy League, PhD. Me. Right. Don't get me wrong, not that I don't love to shapeshift, right? I love that I can go into my old neighborhood in New York and people will speak to me in Spanish. I love that I could be, because of the color of my skin, from a number of different places in the world. But this is not what was behind his question, right? He was not motivated by a generous assumption about where I could belong, but by a bigoted assumption about where I didn't belong. And that was, I guess, in the Ivy Leagues. Right? My childhood and my young adulthood were full, and still are, full of these kinds of challenges to my identity, to my achievements. So is it any wonder that at a certain point I started to ask myself whether or not I too was good enough, whether I was, you know, could work hard enough to play in the big leagues. At the early part of my career, my academic career, I was beset with many episodes of just profound insecurity. One in particular I'll share. It was on what should have been the most exciting achievement of my young career was the day that I defended my doctoral dissertation. I worked for years for this, right? Years. I was prepared. I had the full support of my committee. I went in there. We had a great conversation. I walked out. They awarded me distinction, right? Walking then out of the defense, I was going to meet some friends for a celebratory drink. Walking down Broadway, and all of a sudden, it happened. I was having a massive panic attack. And it was so bad that I literally had to hold myself up on the side of a building in order to just kind of get through it. I was so afraid that I was going to faint. Right? It made no sense. Here was a moment when I was receiving recognition, affirmation for my intellectual capabilities, and I was freaking out inside. I eventually learned that this phenomena, this experience, has a name. It's called imposter syndrome. Imposter syndrome is when someone, an individual, usually a very highly motivated, high-achieving individual, feels a profound sense of insecurity and of undeservedness of their achievements, of their skills, of what they know, of what they've done. It's something that has been that was coined in 1978 by two female psychologists who, interestingly, were doing their research on female undergraduate populations. And their research yielded these results, and they ended up calling this concept imposter syndrome. It is not a sort of categorizable mental disorder, although it does share a lot of symptoms with things like anxiety and depression. And it is very, very common. It afflicts women in particular, people of color, and women of color. In my career, at every single important phase, I had this feeling of being an imposter. My dissertation defense, when I got my first big job, when I gave my first big public talk, knocked it out of the park, I was dying inside, okay? When I published my first book. The higher that I went, the more intensely I would feel the sense of insecurity. And again, it was something that was so hard for me to explain. Now, for those of you in the audience for whom this doesn't resonate at all, congratulations, you are lucky, you are actually in the minority. For those of you who identify with any part of this, I have a few suggestions as to how you can help manage or deal and maybe even defeat imposter syndrome, and that's what I'm going to share. These are three things and they kind of build on one another, okay? The first is basically rooted in the idea that imposter syndrome privileges the individual, right? It presumes that we are only ever individuals measured against individuals, right? It's no surprise that imposter syndrome is something that comes out of a society that prizes individual achievement, right? So one solution to this, one thing that's helped me a lot, is to see yourselves relationally. We forget that we exist in non-competitive relationships to people all the time, right? My sense of self is constantly shifting according to whom I'm interacting with. I am a mother to a son. I am a teacher to a student. I'm a daughter to a father. I am also an activist to a cause. I'm a friend to a friend. I'm an interpreter to my dreams. It's never ending, right? This is helpful because it's dynamic. It demonstrates that we can be many things at once, that there's no fixed and isolatable you that has to worry about whether or not you're being authentic or inauthentic. So that's the first thing. The second thing builds on the first, and that is simply to find your tribe. find your crew, find your barcada, your comrades, those people who help you feel and who with whom you feel fundamentally safe, who you can be fundamentally vulnerable with. My crew is very small. I could probably count them all like on one hand, right? But they are my pillars. They are the ones who remind me that I am never just the sum of my achievements, that I am never just the sum of anything, really, because they allow me to simply be. Right? Not be something, but just be. So find those people. Surround yourself with them, even if they're far away. The third strategy for dealing with imposter syndrome is, for me, actually the most important. It's the silver bullet. And it is to realize that imposter syndrome actually is not a syndrome, but it's a symptom. It's a symptom of a much bigger problem, a bigger structure, a bigger system that goes far beyond any individual. From our brick-and-mortar institutions, to our online social media worlds, everything is governed by the notion that we can and we should measure our worth according to our successes, right? That we should measure our worth according to our successes. In this system, we are only producers or consumers. Success stories or failures. We're not helpers, we're not dreamers, we're not people who protest, we're not keepers of secrets, we're not repositories of deep generational knowledge, no. Either producers or consumers, success, failures. In this system, we are taught that we need to lean in. Instead of cultivating the strength to be the kinds of people who can be leaned on in times of need and who can lean on others. In this system, we are told that we are individually in total control of our destinies, and therefore, if you fail, it's all on you, regardless of whatever inequities or inequalities might exist from the start. Right? I spent so much of my early career terrified that I was not smart enough, articulate enough, that I didn't work hard enough, that I wasn't urbane enough, that I did not come from the right background enough in order to thrive in my field. Right? If someone had said to me early on, you're not playing on a level field, your expectations, the expectations of you will either be too low or too high. What had happened was I was internalizing and individualizing deeply seated structures of race and class and gender inequality. If someone had taken me aside earlier and said that these structures exist, I would have at least been able to distinguish what are my personal limitations, and there are many, from what are the limitations that are rigged already in the system, right? People of color, minoritized peoples, marginalized peoples, people from low socioeconomic backgrounds, we are surrounded by spaces in which it is presumed that we do not belong. Spaces of power, spaces of privilege, and when you walk into those spaces, if that's your goal, when you walk into those spaces, you too might encounter a sea of surprised faces. What are you doing here? What kinds of faces? And what I'm asking you tonight is that when you get into those spaces, you stay. And you occupy. And most important, you hold the door open for others like you to enter in. So that's one way to think about defeating imposter syndrome, right? Let me push this a little further and say that many of the institutions in which we work and we study actually benefit from imposter syndrome. Because what better way to get people to do more for less than to convince them that they don't belong there, that they're not good enough to be there, right? Imposter syndrome is much more than an individual affliction. This is really what I'm trying to say. It is a systemic problem of inequality. So, if we want to defeat it, if we want to root it out at its source, self-help is not good enough. Your individual effort is not good enough, right? Working to overcome your individual senses of inadequacy, not going to do it, right? Radical self-care, optimizing your potential, all of those things, those are going to make you feel good, but they're not going to actually defeat imposter syndrome. And in fact, they might actually feed the beast. If we want to really defeat imposter syndrome, here's what I think we need to do. We need to dismantle the expectations and the structures that tell us that we are only as good as what we produce. We need to dismantle the expectation that we should be promoting ourselves 24/7, that we need to be selling ourselves constantly. There's no sure way to lose your true self than to feel like you have to constantly sell yourself, right? Now, there might be entrepreneurs in the audience. Great, you got a great idea. Sell it, sell it, sell it. But it doesn't mean that we have to be entrepreneurial about everything all the time. Now, I'm not trying to be holier than thou. I got an Instagram account. I love a good selfie. Put a filter on that, instant facelift. I love all of it. This is not about vanity. It's not about ego. We all possess those things, right? What this is about is realizing that those things are not reflections of the complex, incredible, rich subjectivities that we all possess. And they are certainly not the path to an unapologetic you. For me, the path has been simple. It has been to seek and find, and where need be, even make with others, an unapologetic us, right? The Ruby Abar song, the name of the song is not me, it's us, right? Find those communities, forge them if you have to, the communities in which we can learn and work and laugh and lead and fight and truly belong. You help make together those communities of an unapologetic us, and I promise your truest selves will emerge. That's all I got. Thank you so much for listening, and I'll look forward to talking to you at the end of the show.